Excellent. Thank you very much. Good morning and welcome to the 20th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People in 2023. I have received apologies from Ross Greer and Stephen Kerr, and I would like to welcome Megan Gallagher, who is joining us this morning as a substitute member of the committee. Good morning, Megan. The first item on our agenda today is an evidence session on the Scottish Education Exchange Programme and further higher education issues. And can I welcome Graham Day, the Minister for Higher and Further Education and Minister for Veterans. And alongside the Minister today, we have Susan Pride, the team lead for HE International, Shazia Razak, strategic lead for University Policy, Governance and Equalities, Jess Dolan, head of Colleges and Economic Impact, and finally Jane Duffy, unit head for Lifetime Skills and Apprenticeships. Thank you all for joining us today, and I can invite the Minister to open up with a short five-minute statement, please.
Morning, Convener, and thank you. I want to thank you for initially inviting me to come before the committee today to discuss plans for an education exchange programme as a replacement for Erasmus Plus, and also can I express my appreciation of your understanding the other week when I had to be in Liverpool on government business. I'm aware that members will want to expand their questioning into other areas of my portfolio, including university funding and college governance, and hence the reason I have this team, these officials with me today to assist in providing the answers members will be looking for. But before we get into those items, I want to make some initial points around our commitment to develop an exchange programme. Scotland's an open and inclusive country in which we welcome and benefit from students who come to study in some of our many first-class further and higher education institutions. And equally, learners residing in Scotland benefit from international study exchanges in many ways. In 2021-22, we welcomed a record number of 82,000 international students through a range of programmes, including scholarships. I'm grateful to the work of our colleges, universities and international offices in continuing to ensure Scotland's global presence and reputation as a place to learn, study, develop and work. Erasmus has been an integral part of our international exchange offer for many years. The last round of Erasmus Plus funding, which was between 2014 and 2020, awarded over €141 million to in excess of 1,000 Scottish projects. This enabled over 2,200 university students and 200 higher education staff from Scotland to participate in Erasmus Plus. Annually. Proportionately, more students from Scotland took part in Erasmus than any other country in the UK, and more students came to Scotland than any other part of the UK, a testament to our institutions. As the committee is all too aware, the UK government's decision not to associate with Erasmus Plus after leaving the EU prevents Scotland from participating fully in its own right. In May, YouthLink Scotland shared with the committee evidence of the positive impact the Erasmus Plus programme had on the lives of our young people and professionals who support them. As YouthLink revealed, research has shown that the young people who engage with our youth work sector gain the most from these experiences and that it's transformative and life-changing for them. These programmes remove barriers and provide opportunities for more positive future paths for our young people. Convener, I'm sure the committee will agree with me when I say again it's with deep frustration that I acknowledge the negative impact on the young people of Scotland from the UK government's decision to withdraw from Erasmus+. In 2021, the UK government launched the touring scheme as a replacement for Erasmus+, and I'm pleased that Scottish institutions have secured £17.6 million in the first 2 years of touring. Unfortunately, though, touring does not match the breadth and scope of Erasmus+, as it offers no provision for students to come to the UK or for staff exchanges. The Scottish Government will continue to engage with the UK Government to try and make touring better reflect the needs of Scotland. While remaining committed to the Erasmus Plus programme and working with the UK Government to address the shortfalls in the touring scheme, the Scottish Government pledged to create a Scottish Education Exchange programme which would support people from across our education system. My officials have been engaging with universities and other partners from across the education system to identify opportunities for collaboration on a Scottish programme which will not only seek to address shortfalls in the touring scheme but will promote Scotland as an outward-looking country, internationally connected and a positive destination for work and study. But I'm keen, not least of all in view of the immensely challenging financial climate, that we get the best return for the students and staff involved from the investment we make. And with that in mind, I undertook during a meeting with University of Scotland yesterday to engage directly with that sector. I'll also be looking for input from other sectors to shape the final proposals. We recognise the key role exchange programmes play in supporting our priorities, and it is with this in mind that I will commit to update the committee following on from that engagement on the timetable for delivery of the commitment. Finally, Convener, let me thank the committee for this opportunity to come to you today and share that and answer any questions you may have.
Thank you very much, Minister, and on time as well. I appreciate that. Can I move to questions from members? And first up is Willie Rennie, please.
Thanks for that opening statement. Why are we way behind Wales on this? Why have they got their scheme up and running and we are still discussing ours?
I can't speak for what Wales are doing, and you'll hopefully appreciate, Mr. Rennie, I've only been in post for 12 weeks. What I would say about where we are currently and what we need to do is that there's a number of things I think we need to look at to get this right. So, for example, I'd like to assess the allocations around touring that were made to Scottish institutions in 2022-23 to help determine what the gaps actually are. What is it that gets awarded funding, what isn't, and why? Because that will help us understand what we would need to look to plug. As you know, there's no inward mobility element to it, no inward and outward mobility for staff, and of course there's no youth element either. So we know that. But we need to understand the basis on which touring awards, and we are waiting shortly to see what the awards will be for 23-24, which will also inform our thinking. But in terms of where we are currently, we are actively engaged on this. What I would anticipate us doing in the next short while is to launch a pilot project in conjunction with the sectors that I've mentioned. And then take it from there. That would be my intention at the moment.
OK, can you give us a bit more detail about when the pilot project would start?
You appreciate having just started those conversations with University of Scotland. I can't do that, but I would anticipate it being in this financial year.
So you're new in post, but there has been a higher education minister and further education minister before, and it has taken a long time just to get to this stage. I've been given numerous excuses by various ministers over the time, including the free movement of people. I've tried to establish whether this is a real problem, and I can't find any evidence that there is an issue about free movement of people. Have you managed to find anything?
So, there has been extensive engagement on that. We believe that the scheme would be covered by a six-month study visa, so that would take account of a term. So we believe it will be OK, but we still await final confirmation on that.
Are you going to fund the scheme, or are you expecting further and higher education institutions to pay for this?
We will take forward the pilot project at the moment in conjunction with those institutions. I recognise the financial challenges that they face, just as I recognise the ones that the government face as well.
OK. That's not quite you'll pay for it. This is an SNP manifesto commitment. I would have thought you would have funded it from central funds.
I would anticipate that the government would be the forefront of funding this.
Forefront. OK.
All right, Billy. Is that you?
That's fine. Yep.
OK. Pam Duncan Clancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Minister, for your opening statement and for joining us this morning. It's appreciated. I'm still really struggling to understand why we're in a situation where 6,000 students in Wales have participated in an exchange programme across 95 countries, and the Scottish Government are still only piloting a project which might not even start to the end of this financial year.
Well, as you're well aware, Ms Duncan Glancy, one of the significant challenges for the government currently and previously has been budget. We faced enormous budget challenges, and that's been a factor in, as Mr Rennie would put it, holding up the development of this. There's no doubt about that. But that doesn't mean we're not going to fulfil this commitment.
So presumably the Welsh Government made different budgetary choices then. So why did the Scottish Government not choose to fund its manifesto commitment on this?
With respect, Ms Duncan Glancy, one of the joys of being an opposition member in this Parliament is that you can call you and other opposition members for funding for all sorts without actually having to determine where it comes from. You talk about funding choices, but a number of the funding commitments that this government has made, I haven't heard opposition members criticising.
With respect, it's not for the opposition to tell the government how to fund their own manifesto.
No, but it is for the opposition to show a sense of responsibility around what they call for, I would contend, with respect.
But the opposition in this situation are calling for exactly the same thing the government did. I feel we could go round in circles on that particular...
So I'm just going to ask you to move on.
Yeah, that particular question. So I will move on. In terms of the conversation you had with University Scotland and the pilot project, you've said you're looking to find what the gaps in tutoring are and look particularly at youth work. We heard extensive evidence last week of the gaps in tutoring and the value of youth work. Do you not have enough information just to start this?
So, let me be clear. I did not share with the university yesterday the specifics of a pilot project we committed. We're meeting next week, so the committee is the first to hear about that. We do have quite a lot of information on the youth side of it, absolutely, but I want to understand fully what the gaps are in their entirety in tutoring, because I'm sure, and rightly so, if we were to design a scheme and further down the line there were found to be unintended consequences or shortcomings, members of Parliament, this committee, would rightly hold the government to account. I want to be sure that what we're doing meets the needs, insofar as that's achievable, of the young people and the staff and the support workers who'll be caught up in this.
Conversations, according to Youth Like Scotland and others last week, conversations on this ceased in the middle of last year. So if the government isn't really intent on finding out what the issues are, I'm afraid I cannot understand what's taken the length of time. It feels like, is the government just waiting to say we want full Erasmus Plus after independence, or are you going to genuinely try and do something before?
We've already said that, and I've already told you what we're going to do.
Okay.
So you're going. So
We've already been very clear that we would fully align with Erasmus post independence. The point, what I'm saying to you is that we have a plan to introduce a pilot project this year to get this up and running, and that's what we're going to do.
Pilot, not a replacement.
There will be a pilot to inform the development of the replacement.
2.5 years after the commitment.
Thank you. Bob Doris wants a supplementary on this thread, if that's possible.
Yeah, on supplementary on the pilot, I come back in later on the budget of it, but just specifically on the pilot.
Okay.
If that's okay,
yeah.
Convener. Minister, you mentioned that you've spoken to universities recently, about this, of course. There's three moving parts to this. There's universities, there's colleges, and there's the youth sector. And we're talking about a pilot, and the government's got a kind of commitment to widening access and targeting resources at those most in need and least likely to get that overseas and foreign travel. Can we anticipate that, having spoken to universities, that it will not necessarily be university-led, it could be college-led, it could be youth sector-led, and it could be targeted at those least likely to be mobile and travel in Europe in the first place? Will this be a targeted pilot at those most in need, Minister?
It will certainly take account of those most in need. And to be clear, the conversation with the universities happened yesterday because we were meeting them. I'm meeting College of Scotland next week. I met the youth sector just quite recently, and we'll follow up on that.
So just finally, on that, we take account of the fact that those who don't go to college or university are least likely to undertake overseas travel. Those going to university are the most likely, and those around colleges are somewhere in the middle. Will that be taken account of in any pilot?
I'm acutely aware of the evidence the committee took. I think it was Pam Duncan Glancy's line at the question at that session, and I was quite taken by that. So we're not looking to ultimately have a project that excludes people. That's not what we're looking to do. We're trying to capture everyone who ought to be captured.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for those responses. Can we move to questions from Ruth Maguire now, please?
Thank you. Yeah, I think I probably want to echo colleagues' sentiments there that in times where resources are stretched, it would feel inappropriate if those who were furthest away from getting opportunities missed out. So it's good to hear that the Minister will be engaging with the youth work and colleges sector. In terms of the current tutoring scheme, youth work's an obvious gap there. You mentioned that you will engage with the UK government. What scope do you see for improvement or changes to be made to tutoring that Scottish young people can take advantage of?
Well, I think we can all see the scope that there would be for improvement. I'll bring my officials in on that to answer in detail because they've been involved.
So I'll come in and answer a bit of that. So yes, we're aware. I mean, the touring scheme is ultimately focused at the disadvantaged kind of levels of funding where it goes. So it expects about at least 50% of the funding that they provide to go to those areas. Just to say that there are some projects that are not just focused on higher and further education that do have exchanges that are related to youth sectors, not specifically the kind of youth sector in the way we've spoken about it, but things like through schools, through, I guess, associations, clubs. So there are successful projects that have been awarded money through touring to that.
Can I ask what level of engagement the Scottish Government is having with the UK Government about the touring scheme?
Yeah, I mean, we basically meet on about a monthly basis in relation to touring, and that's all parts of the UK, not just Scotland as a devolved administration. Also, recently, their provider, Capita, have introduced a couple of boards to get feedback. So they have one for universities and one for colleges. And I think they have for schools as well, but I'm not totally versed in that. But we do have University Scotland and College Scotland on these boards. So they are providing direct input of any, I guess, concerns, any problems that are coming up arising through the touring funding and how it could be improved and made better. So we're making sure that that's directly fed in to the planning for future touring rounds.
Thank you, that's helpful.
Ruth, now Stephanie Callaghan, over to yourself now.
Thank you very much, Convener. We certainly heard a lot of really positive stuff around TAFE and evidence, and youth work were saying as well, you know, it hits all their kind of key asks. So I'm wondering, are you looking at that as being a kind of possible blueprint going forward, or what do you see as being the key lessons around that?
Okay, Susan, because she's been leading on that.
Yeah. So we have engaged a lot with our Thai colleagues specifically, our TAFE colleagues specifically, as they were setting up the programme. We do meet Welsh Government officials on a monthly basis, and we've been keeping up on the allocations and how they've been doing that, how their applications, assessment procedures have been working. And absolutely, yes, we're looking at that, and as well learning lessons from touring and looking at the application assessment procedures and what would be appropriate for Scotland and how we can make sure that we make that work appropriately for Scotland.
And just a quick follow-up, can I ask, to what extent is that influencing the pilot work that you're looking at just now?
I think ultimately, yes, it will, but I think the first step for any pilot is to have a good discussion with the stakeholders and actually lay out some of that thinking and plans with them. Obviously, they won't have experienced TAFE, but they have experienced touring, and we know what their views on how that process works, what works well, what doesn't work so well. So, yes, we'll be bringing all of that kind of into discussion when we start the discussion on the pilot with stakeholders to actually look at what would work best for Scotland and how we could, I guess, look at especially kind of key principles of how we tackle disadvantage, how we look at key Scottish Government priority areas and how those, I guess, exchanges happen and what kind of areas they happen in.
And are you able to say any more at this point on who and how you're intending engaging with your youth work specifically?
Well, we've had regular meetings. I guess, you know, we talked about some meetings being paused. Up until February this year, we've been having a monthly meeting with YouthLink Scotland. So we do have a really strong, I would say, working relationship with them. So I don't see any problem in involving them in discussing a pilot programme.
So the focus will remain in YouthLink Scotland?
Sorry.
So the focus will remain in YouthLink Scotland?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
I've got a question from Megan Gallagher now, please.
Thank you, Convener, and it's to pick up on the youth work aspect, because Liz Green, when she was here at committee and I was present at that meeting, said that progress had stalled last summer, last autumn time, and that regular meetings with the government had stopped in roughly January, February. I appreciate that you're new in post, Minister, but do you know why those meetings stopped? Because if you're looking to have a youth element, which I do believe is important, then you know you do need to be having regular meetings with stakeholders.
Yeah, and I think much of the groundwork had already been done in that regard in determining what it was they were looking for, what they felt was required. But to be absolutely clear, one of the reasons, perhaps one of the most significant reasons why this has not progressed at a pace we would all have wanted it to, is budget. That has been an issue. You're all aware of the significant budgetary challenges the government's facing the education portfolio. And that's been a factor in the pace at which this has progressed.
Quick supplementary, thank you, Convener. So I can take your point on that, but that comes down to choices, Minister, and all governments do make choices. But what I would have expected, given the budgetary concerns that you have voiced this morning, that would have been brought to Cabinet to be discussed at a higher level. Now, my understanding is that the Student Exchange Programme has not been brought to the Scottish Government Cabinet. Please correct me if I am wrong there. But there doesn't seem to be a consistent thread of reporting on the Student Exchange Programme. So can I ask why that isn't the case and why there hasn't been progress reports provided? Because I think, again, that's an important element of the implementation of the programme, is to make sure that people are updated on the progress that the government is making.
I'm not aware what hasn't been discussed at Cabinet and what updates have provided, recognising I've been 12 weeks in post. What I can say is that there's a PFG commitment has been made. There was no timeline to the PFG commitment, but the commitment is made, and we intend to take that forward. So I've been as open as I can be with the committee this morning about where we're at and how we're going to try and progress this in the short term.
Do you think, just final question, Convener, do you think, therefore, that with the pilot being launched this year, that the government will be able to fully have this implemented by its initial date of September 2025?
I'm not aware that there was a firm timeline set in place. It was a PFG commitment. Mm-hmm. I mean, what I would say to you is that we would, I said this financial year, we would look to get the pilot up and running. I'd like to get it up and running quite quickly, but we want to get it right. And I'm hoping that can inform some reasonably rapid progression from that point on. I think, if I recall rightly, what we said is it would be done within this Parliament. Now, we would all like to do it, get it done as early in the Parliament as possible. And that's what we're trying to do just now, to put some momentum into this.
Okay. Thank you, Camino.
Thank you. And Bob Dorris, you want to come in on this thread?
Budgetary
yes.
concerns, if that's okay.
Uh-huh. And then I've got the Vice-Convener.
Okay. Minister, I think it is reasonable to assert that the financial position of the Scottish Government has dramatically eroded since the manifesto commitments were made, be that due to inflation, cost pressures within education and UK government austerity. I mean, that's a strong argument for yourself as Minister. However, this committee still has to scrutinise the potential budget lines irrespective of all of that. So the Welsh scheme is £65 million over 4 years. That would be about £16.25 million per annum as a fully rolled out scheme. Is there any indicative figures that whether the government pays at all or in part for this pilot that the government can share with us at the moment?
It's difficult to share figures, Mr. Dorris, at this stage because of the forms that the scheme could take. But what I will undertake to do is to provide as much information to the committee as we move this forward and to return to it on the subject if you so wish.
Okay. That would be helpful, and as soon as it's possible to get an idea of those figures. We get figures can move and change and projections can change, but early sight of figures would be helpful for this committee. Because this committee will also have to make choices, Convener, because of all the cost pressures and demands that this committee makes. So if the Scottish Government was to come forward and say, we have found £25 million per annum to run this scheme, committee members are going to have to decide if that's the best spend of £25 million within the sector, given the cuts to colleges in particular and other cost pressures that exist. So this committee's got moving parts to compete with as well in relation to budgetary concerns. Are you sensitive, Minister, that any spend on this manifesto commitment might have an impact on other commitments we're making within the education portfolio, and how would you manage that conflict?
Of course you're conscious of where funding has to be found from. You know, that's made up my last 12 weeks with some of the challenges that's gone with that. And on occasion, Mr. Doris, there can be budgetary pressures that arise. The teachers' pay settlement was a very significant pressure. But I see this as a priority now. We need to get on and do something with it, and that's what I intend to do.
Finally, Convener, will this be wholly funded within the education portfolio, or will any money external within government be deployed to help meet these ambitions?
I'm not clear on that at the moment.
Okay, thank you.
Can we bring in the Vice Convener, Ben McPherson, now, please?
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and to your officials. Just a quick question going back to engagement. It was really good to hear about the regular engagement with the Welsh Government, because the officials working on the TAFE programme had said there hadn't been some engagement for some time. It was my anticipation that while there had not been engagement with those specific officials in the Welsh Government, that there would be regular engagement with yourselves and other members of the Welsh Government, and it was great to hear that clarity from you. Indeed, it was also helpful to hear about the engagement with UK Government on Turing and what can be learned and considered in that regard. But given the Scottish Government has such high esteem and respect in Brussels and Scotland's position on the European question is so strong, I presume there's also good engagement with relevant persons and authorities, not just from the Scottish Government, but from our institutions, with partners in Brussels that can be utilised to come up with the best scheme possible.
Well, not just Brussels. I mean, one of the strengths of our universities is the international contacts they have and the respect in which they're held. And that's one of the reasons why I want to utilise what they can bring to the table to develop this in the best possible way. I should say as well, going back to a point that Willie Rennie made about my predecessor, when there's a change of minister, very often those ministers want to look very closely, as I have, at what's on their desk. And that, you know, may well have held this up a little bit as well, because I want to be absolutely clear on the best approach that we should take to this. And we're not quite there yet. But I want to take that little bit more time to be convinced about what's the best way to go here. And that includes those conversations with the universities, the colleges and the youth sector. So we get this right.
I welcome that. Thank you, Minister.
I'm Duncan Clancy. You have a...
Not now. No.
All right. OK. Thank you. Thank you very much. So we're going to move on to just... Willie Rennie, sorry.
Just to follow up... To be blunt, I don't think your predecessor did very much on this, and I welcome the fact that you've put new energy into this and have made a commitment on the pilot. I think that's good news. The scale of the pilot, however, is important, because already Bob Doris has talked and others have talked about, you know, making sure that youth work is included in it. If the pilot is off, if we're going to learn enough from the pilot, we will need to include all the sectors. Can be guaranteed that all the sectors will be included? And my second question is, in Wales, the system is run by, I think it's Cardiff University. Are you proposing to commission some other organisation to run this pilot and the eventual scheme in the long run?
In answer to the first question, yes. In answer to the second question, that's not been decided.
Thank you.
Not often we get yes answers from ministers, so that was so. Thank you. We're going to move on to other topics, just so you can brace yourselves there. And you said earlier, and you mentioned on numerous occasions that you met with the universities yesterday. So I was wondering if there was any discussion that took place regarding the ongoing boycott of marking across some of the universities, and what that discussion may have looked like.
Well. That was obviously in the confines of a private meeting. But yes, that subject was aired.
And can the Minister comment on perhaps his opinion of the ongoing boycott and how that may impact on the students that are sitting without confirmed results for their degrees?
I mean, I can talk to the conversations I've had, and perhaps officials can add to that. I've certainly spoken to... I met UCU... for the universities last week. We had a discussion around the circumstances surrounding this. I had further discussion with the universities yesterday. I think it's a regrettable situation that we find ourselves in and the impact that's having on students. I think in the university sector it's indicative of a very strained relationship that exists between the trade unions and management. And I have urged management in Scotland to seek to have UCEA get back round the table with the trade unions to try and make progress in resolving this, because that's the only way we're going to get this sorted out. In terms of the approaches, individual universities have taken different approaches as to how they address the impacts of the Marken boycott, and the impacts are varied depending on the institutions. It's not an entirely satisfactory situation that we find ourselves, not at all, but we need to get this resolved.
Have you spoken to any students, Minister, regarding how they're feeling about this at all?
I've had limited conversations with students. I mean, we are meeting the National Union of Students next week, I think it is, as a body.
OK. I know that there's some quite animated discussions on various radio programmes yesterday when you were hearing about the frustrations that they were feeling. So, OK. Can I move now to questions from Pam Duncan Clancy? Are you ready?
You can. Yeah. Yes, thank you. Thank you for that. Can I ask what feedback have you had from college principals following the letter that you sent to them about their responsibilities on Fair Work?
Directly, I had a couple of college principals got in touch with me to offer reassurance about the approach they took. Indirectly through Colleges Scotland, I've had similar reassurances that the overwhelming majority of colleges are seeking to take the appropriate approach, which is reassuring. But I recognise also the concerns that are being expressed by the trade unions.
And what would you suggest that we say to our constituents who are losing their jobs as a result of redundancies?
Well, I think we had this conversation a few weeks ago in this very room. I think redundancies are deeply regrettable, but we are in a very, very challenging financial position. And we have to get through this. And as I think I said again to you a few weeks ago, the work that's going on currently directly with the colleges, which will be ramped up next week, to try and find things that we can do to stabilise the causes. That won't address the problem right immediately now and the retrospective problem that they're dealing with, but it will hopefully get them on a sounder financial footing and have the stability that we need them to have for going forward.
And do you accept that the cut in funding this year, the £46 million and £26 for colleges, could have impacted on that? Some colleges, for example, have said that they may have been able to use that for a voluntary severance scheme, as opposed to move to compulsory.
They wouldn't have been able to use it for a voluntary severance scheme. Let's be absolutely, I think I said that previously. That those monies, so the flat cash settlement is their core funding. The £26 million was for transition projects, which were still under discussion. The nature, the type of those were under discussion with the funding council. They would not have been able to use those for voluntary severance schemes.
I mean, we did get four different answers about what that money was for, so I don't think that was actually particularly clear. What kind of engagement have you had with colleges around the impact of the redundancies? Who's losing their jobs? Are they lecturers, for example, who are working in additional support courses? Are they on courses that we need in areas that we need skills in Scotland? Is this, have you had any engagement whatsoever from with colleges on that?
So, as a minister, I would not directly engage in operational matters, but from the conversations that I've had, where I've been visiting colleges and other meetings with college principals, the principals have, as I understand it, sought to protect the courses that are absolutely required to be protected. And those include the type of courses that you have highlighted. I specifically asked principals around that point, and they've been very clear with me. Now, you may have examples which I'd be interested in if that hasn't been the case. But I think, for the most part, as far as I'm aware, colleges and their principals have sought to protect those courses. But as I say, if you have evidence to the contrary, I'm happy to hear that.
Yeah, so I have some evidence from Glasgow specifically, which I may follow up separately, but there are significant reductions in the City of Glasgow College in the additional support needs area, so that would be helpful to follow up separately. What support can you offer staff who are facing redundancies at this time?
In what sense?
Well, if they're going to lose their job, what more can the government do to support them?
The government, I think, would you like to give me an example of what you think the government should be doing?
I mean, I could. I think the government should have, over the last 10 years, properly funded the sector so that it can afford to employ the staff that it needs. I think that it needs to look at flexibilities, but it's not my job to answer that question, Minister. It's ultimately, there are people, particularly in Glasgow, but I won't focus on it, but across the sector, facing job losses at a time where we really need colleges the most. We need skills in our economy. We need colleges to be the engine rooms in our local communities of learning, skills and development, and supporting people from poorer backgrounds specifically. And at this moment in time, those institutions are laying people off.
So, to pick up on your point, there has been additional money going into colleges over the last few years. I recognise the financial challenges they still face, absolutely. But if your point is, well, you should have just put more money into colleges, I guess my challenge to you is, Ms. Dunlop-Glancy, from where? Because I don't think anyone on this committee would have been calling for us not to put more money in to tackle the attainment challenge, not to settle the teachers' pay dispute, and various other things which are rightly priorities. And I'm afraid, sadly and regrettably, in the context of the colleges right now, they face a situation where they are having to make redundancies, hopefully minimised, whilst we look, because you're absolutely right about the future, the colleges will be front and centre on what we're going to be doing. So we need to try and stabilise them now and get them into a better position for what lies ahead. But we are in a difficult financial position at the moment, very difficult.
Thank you. I appreciate that. But I don't think that we can continue to get into this back and forth where you expect opposition members to do
this.
This
is a back and forth as well, Ms. Duncan-Glancy. We've had this already. Can we move to a question?
It is, and I am. Thank you, Convener. The point that I'm trying to make is that there are people going to lose their jobs in a sector that the government has said is important. Have they come too late to negotiations? Did you use all the money up before it came to colleges?
There was an additional pressure, as the committee is aware, that arose as the consequence of settling the teachers' pay dispute. That money had to be found from within the education budget. That's the nature of government.
Do you think it's acceptable to put educators against educators in that circumstance?
We've had this exchange previously, I think, in the chamber. The simple fact is, if the money isn't there, it can't be magicked up. I absolutely regret the pressures that the colleges are under and the redundancies that are having to be made, but I'm afraid that's the reality of the situation.
OK, I have one final question.
No, can we move to questions now from Bob Dorris? Thank you.
Minister, I don't expect to comment on City of Glasgow College, but I want to use it briefly as a case study for corporate governance. So we know that EIS Fela had plans to mitigate the 100 compulsory redundancies that are looming in Glasgow. EIS Fela tell us that the principal described those plans as nebulous and superficial and rejected by the board on the 14th of June. EIS Fela would say that the 18 different papers that have been taken forward for those 100 redundancies have errors and inconsistencies, and we know that scoring exercises have started to deem who might be made compulsory redundant, with redundancies potentially as early as the 28th of June, and we know the unions asked for that process to be delayed. OK. So there's where we are with the City of Glasgow College. What reassurance can MSPs in Glasgow have, or indeed MSPs elsewhere in the country with their local colleges, that when boards consider proposals from unions or anyone else, they do so fairly, robustly, in detail and prudently? How can we make sure that's happening without casting any aspersions on anyone, Minister? Because if we've got unions saying they've not been considered appropriately and robustly, how can we reassure unions that they have been, or what checks and balances exist that MSPs can reassure ourselves that
things are not going awry within the college sector and in corporate governance in particular.
Yeah, I don't want to get into the specifics of one particular example, but I think you raise a good point about the robust nature of oversight in any locality with college boards, and also the role of the SFC. I realise I've come to a point where I can stop making this comment, but I've been in post 12 weeks. I'm still getting my head around some of the nature of the processes that are followed. But the SFC, as I understand it, they've given an assurance that due process was followed in that particular example. What I'm alive to at that institution is the very fractious nature of industrial relations that see a claim and counterclaim made. As politicians, as the government, we have to deal in fact. But a more general point around college governance, I think it's certainly something I'm taking a keen interest in terms of the form that it takes.
Okay, can you say any more about that, Minister? And I'm keen to move away from the City of Glasgow College. I'm sure constituents will be listening very carefully to our exchange on the City of Glasgow College, but there are colleges across the country. I've no doubt some are performing very well. They've got close relationships with their union colleagues, but not so much in others. I'm sure some will have robust challenging of college principals, others perhaps not so much. How do we get that consistency of approach to scrutiny? If this was Housing Associations, Minister, and there were issues, then there's the ability to appoint individuals to boards to support that oversight, for example.
Yeah, I'll bring Jess in a minute on the detail of some of this. But to answer the specific point, one issue that's come across my desk in the last few weeks, and there are no doubt good reasons for this, but if a college is conducting a process of voluntary severance, that has to be run past the funding council, but not if they're conducting an exercise in compulsory redundancy. And I think that's a little bit anomalous in terms of the very point you're making about that oversight of processes, and it is something that I'm keen to have a look at.
Finally,
would
it be best practice for colleges going for compulsory redundancies, even though they don't have to run it past the funding council anyway? Would that be best practice?
Well, it's not necessary at the moment. But I can understand why that isn't happening. I have to look to what we might do in the future to ensure that, as I say, I saw your reaction to my pointing out that anomaly. I think you get where I'm coming from. I think there's something there that we need to look at.
There's nothing to prevent colleges going to the funding council, ask them to check it over anyway, even though they don't have a legal duty to do so. And that might be best practice.
There would be nothing to stop them.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Willie Rennie now, please. Thank you.
I just want to follow up on the evolution of the no compulsory redundancy policy. We discussed it last week in the chamber. Mike Russell, when he was Education Secretary, said this party believes there is no place for compulsory redundancies in Scotland's colleges. But subsequent to that, colleges got closer to government but have been excluded from the no compulsory redundancy policy. Can you explain the rationale for that?
Not a specific way, because it very much predates my time in post. They're required to pay heed to public sector pay policy, but they're not bound by it. That's the nature of the structures that they have.
Okay, I would have hoped that you would have had an understanding as to why it's changed.
Because this changed, is quite a... But it's always been that way. I think you, the quote that you said it was that the Cabinet Secretary at that point believed there was no place for that. Yeah. They weren't bound by it, is my understanding.
Yeah, but at that point they were further away from government, but then the ONS reclassification brought them closer to government. So there's an opportunity, but a specific decision was taken to separate them from bodies like the Cairngorm National Park, the Crofton Commission, the Risk Management Authority, Scottish Canals, all of those who are bound by the policy, they're public sector bodies. Colleges are also public sector bodies, but a decision was taken to allow compulsory redundancies to take place. surely we must have an understanding as to why that happened.
Is there NDPBs with boards?
But they're still public sector bodies. A decision could have been taken to include them in the public sector pay policy, which was no compulsory redundancies.
I think, Mr. Reddy, and I don't want to duck your question, it long predates my involvement in this role.
Okay. I do think that's unsatisfactory. I would hope that you could maybe write to us later on and just give an explanation for that.
Is that you, Mr. Rennie?
Yeah.
Okay. Stephanie Callaghan now, please, if that's okay.
Thanks very much, Convener. And I'm sure you won't be surprised that I'm interested in the Lanarkshire Colleges. The current governance arrangements aren't ideal and distract both the Lanarkshire Colleges from their main focus around students and economic recovery. And the efforts to make the governance work just now with RSBs is time-consuming for the board and the executive and unlikely to change outcomes for students and for communities. And I'm just wondering if you're able to provide firmer timescales around governance options for Lanarkshire and for Glasgow.
Around the City of Glasgow, there has obviously been an ask from the three existing colleges that we revisit the GCRB structures. We are currently considering the options around that. But there's a bit of a simplistic view about the process. So I think there is a view held that we could simply move to this fairly quickly. I think I answered a question to Pam Duncan-Glancy in the chamber on this. We're currently identifying what the legislative process is to do that. If it were primary legislation, it could take quite some time. If it were to be achievable through secondary legislation, it could still take, because we have to consult on it under the legislation, somewhere between 9 to 12 months. So there's not an immediate change that could be facilitated. I'm aware of what the colleges would wish. I'm aware of Mr. Doris's view about the how the monies that are caught up in running GCRB could be better spent. I'm also acutely aware of the staff that work for GCRB, and this is a very unsettling time for them while all this speculation is ongoing. So I'm keen that we get to the point where we can indicate what our thinking is around this. But in all circumstance, it's important that the governance that exists, whether it be at individual college level, regional level, provides appropriate oversight, because this is, I think that's essential. So again, back to the answer I made to Willie Rennie at the outset on the initial subject, we're taking a little bit of time just now to consider the best way to proceed on this, and absolutely we'll write to the committee once we reach that point.
Okay, and Megan Gallagher on this topic, please.
Thank you, Convener. And if I could continue with the budgetary issues theme and the impact that this is having on our college estates, and like Bob Doris, I'd like to use New College Lanarkshire as a case study, because in the Motherwell campus we've seen the halls of residency close, and in the Cumbernauld and Coatbridge campuses we've seen the nursery close as well. So it's not just impacting the hard-working staff within those facilities, it's also impacting our learners, whether that be rural young people, rural people looking to study in more urban areas, or students with young children. And one example, and I referenced this during the debate last week, was a young person from Argyll who is now no longer able to go to college because of the situation they find themselves in with the Motherwell campus and the student accommodation closing. So I think we're now moving beyond the deeply regrettable stage. I think we're now moving into the direct consequence that budgetary issues are now facing with our young people in particular. So can I ask what support the government is offering to students that find themselves in those circumstances? Or is the government perhaps saying to rural young people that you can't go to college in these circumstances because of these budgetary cuts?
That's not what we're saying at all. And I think you know that. There is considerable support provided to a number of rural-based colleges across the country. UHI, the Borders will be two examples of that, to ensure that our young people residing in rural settings are able to access colleges on their doorstep or as close as possible. And there is great opportunity as well moving forward to use technology to improve the offering that's available remotely at a number of these settings, so it's enhanced. In the context of New College, Lanarkshire, and the specific examples that you've given, it's not for ministers. Ministers do not have a role in the operational decisions of individual colleges. Now, you were right, you raised the halls of residence point with me in the chamber last week. I thought that the nursery issue had been paused until December, whilst they're still looking at that. So I don't doubt that there are very difficult decisions that colleges are having to take right now. And there are consequences to those. I recognise that. And that's why the very detailed dialogue that we're entered into with the colleges is so important. And it's a very constructive dialogue about what can we do to enable the colleges to become more sustainable in the short term and the medium term. And that's the spirit in which those discussions are taking place. And they'll be ramped up next week when I meet them directly.
Thank you for your response, Minister. However, are we saying, therefore, that rural young people need to stay in rural settings? Because I think rural young people should have that flexibility that they can move into to urban settings should they wish to learn in urban settings. But as it stands just now, particularly with the case of New College Lanarkshire, we're actually closing the door on rural young people from being able to enter those premises. But going back on the... I understand that it's not the government's role to tell colleges what to do, but if New College Lanarkshire is facing a £4.3 million cut, they have no option but to look at these. And I understand in relation to the nursery issue that that's not going to... It's going to be reviewed in December, but what security is that given to people who work in those settings? What security is that given to students who are on courses just now and might need to find alternative childcare at the last moment?
So I recognise that point. And, of course, I could come back and say to you that as a member, you've certainly highlighted the need for additional investment in early years and no doubt various other things. We have a fixed budget in education. We can't do everything. But I want to pick up on what is a very important point you make about the opportunity for youngsters who might be in the rural settings, or it could be reversed. They live in an urban setting, they want to go to college in a rural setting. And one of the things I think the Withers proposals does is give us the opportunity to look at how we provide college education, because we tend currently to focus on university students who will travel to different parts of the country to do courses. I think there's an opportunity through Withers to perhaps look at that in a college setting. So, for example, we are going to have to put an emphasis on the needs of the economy, but there will be other courses that are absolutely essential. And it may well be that some of our colleges become centres of excellence. And if we're going to do that, because that's a conversation we've got to have, then of course we've got to look at how we would support college students to go and attend those particular centres of excellence. So you could see rural to urban migration, but we could also see the reverse. There are some really good gamekeeping courses, for example, provided at Borders College, and I don't doubt there will be some urbanites that want to go in those colleges. So we need to look going forward at how we deliver that.
No, I think that's a point that we can agree on, Minister, but therefore I hope you do share my concerns that if the student accommodation is closing, that's directly affecting young people from doing that. And finally, Convener, if I may, on the back of the issues surrounding New College Lanarkshire, Unison are actually calling now for a review of college finances and governance. So I'm wondering what the Minister's response is to that and whether a full review will take place.
So if what you're referring to is some form of emergency funding package for colleges, or the general approach to funding, we're not in a position, absolutely not in a position, to provide additional funding to colleges right now. In terms of what future funding looks like going forward, Withers is very clear that there is no shortage of funding in the skills and post-schools education landscape. It's very clear about that. It's just how we better utilise that. And that will form part of the discussion that we have around Withers and taking that and various other things forward.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you,
Convener. And that actually is a nice segue into questions from Ruth Maguire. Please.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, I hear loud and clear what you're saying about fixed budgets and the financial constraints that everyone's having to operate under. As well as making choices between funding things or not, I think it's important that we make sure that our public bodies have all the tools they need to be able to operate. And so operational and financial flexibility has become very important. I know I've asked you about this a number of times, and Convener will keep asking about it. Some of the flexibilities being provided were outlined by the Cabinet Secretary in her response to committee to our college regionalisation inquiry report. Can I ask you about how discussions are progressing between the Scottish Government and Colleges Scotland? If you can speak to potential shorter term and longer term solutions, if that's possible, and also understand that there may be opportunity for flexibility around resource, operation and capital. So anything that you can say to that would be helpful for a committee to hear.
So, as I said to the member in the debate the other week, and I don't want to be unhelpful, hopefully I come across as wanting to be helpful to the committee, but it's a bit of a difficult situation to sit and talk about discussions that haven't taken place yet, and B, I think it would be a bit disrespectful to the colleges if I was to talk about some of our thinking. What the Cabinet Secretary outlined, I think, when she was in front of the committee, when I was a member of it, was about the flexibilities that had been provided and have been welcomed by the colleges. But I recognise that we need to go further in order to support them. So the approach that's been taken is that the colleges have been working up a number of thoughts that they have, as have we. We're going to come together next week, not to have a discussion and wander off and come back to this after the recess, but with a view to looking at what is achievable now and in the slightly longer term. Because there's no doubt in my mind that we can do more to assist the colleges into a position of stability. And one of the areas you talked there about capital spend, one of the areas that I'm keen to explore with them is a possible option about how they might be encouraged or assisted to address some of the issues with fabric of their buildings, and also in doing that to address the net zero challenge. So it isn't just about resource, it's about what more can we do, because there are some colleges face significant challenges owing to the age and condition of their buildings, and there have been restrictions, or they felt there have been restrictions on what they can do in that space, which I'm hoping that we can find a way to lessen and encourage some movement in that area.
Convener, I suppose I would just, I'm surprised that discussions hadn't taken place. I thought that's maybe me picking up wrong.
Of course there has been dialogue, mm-hmm.
Okay.
Between the officials, so, progressing this, yeah. But we are meeting next week to try and get this progress significantly.
Okay, I'm glad to hear that, because I think there needs to be a bit of urgency around it. So it's good to hear that we're not at the start. Do you want to say something, Jen?
If that's okay, just to assure you that discussions that have been ongoing for some time, and the meetings the minister's referring to next week are part of an ongoing series of conversations that we've been having with College of Scotland and with college principals feeding into those discussions over a significant number of months. So it's more an iterative process than it is we're waiting for a single meeting to take place.
I appreciate that.
So to be clear, the meeting next week is to try and get agreement on this.
Okay.
To get something firmly in place. And again, Convener, once we're in a position to do that, I would hope we'd be able to write jointly to the committee to outline what's happening.
I think that would be really helpful.
Yeah, because it certainly was something that came out loud and clear in our college's report. We're going to move on to topics around Withers, just so you've got yourself, and moving to Bill Kidd to kick us off, please. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Convener. Minister, you've stated clearly, and we've all heard you, that the Scottish Government will not shy away from skills reform following the recommendations of the Withers Review. and you've mentioned it a couple of times here this morning already. Can you share any further thinking this time on how these recommendations will be enacted, and is there a response in setting out the way forward? When can that be expected?
Okay, so if I may take a moment, convener, to outline the approach we've taken to this. The Withers review is certainly radical. I welcome it, not least of all because it takes a look at the whole skills landscape. We've had reviews previously that have looked at bits and pieces of it. I think it's incredibly useful. I was going to say it started a discussion. It's not about starting a discussion because we are going to make change. However, whilst we warmly welcome the broad direction of travel that Withers sets, there are 15 clear recommendations, five of them structural, and there are significant implications that arise from those, not least of all for individuals as well as organisations. And I just feel it's appropriate that we take a small amount of time now to interrogate the implications of those recommendations. It may be that there's a slightly different way to take forward that work. We might want to go further. There might be some things that, for a variety of reasons that emerge, are not the right thing to do. But in a general sense, Withers, I think, really does point the way forward. It's a terrific report. Now, what form does that little period of time when we reflect on it take? All of the major stakeholders in this we've spoken to already, and we've asked them to take a little bit of time, we're talking 6-8 weeks, to reflect in detail on the Withers report, not only on how it impacts them directly, but in a broader sense, because people may spot things that they might be able to contribute to. I had a meeting with the RSE yesterday, for example, and they're, you know, they've got a good overview of the whole sector, and it'd be useful to hear what their thinking is as well. So I would encourage others to do that. At the conclusion of that rough period, we'll be directly engaged with them to get their thoughts on what they think, how we could implement it, what we ought to do. And I have to say the response generally has been very positive to Withers. Now, I'm conscious that some would have us simply just go and do it now. But I think, particularly when we need to talk to our trade union colleagues, for example, and others, we need to take that little bit of time, and we are thinking this through in great detail. To a rough timetable, I would hope to expect to come back to Parliament early post-recess, whether it's to make a statement, if Parliament wishes that, or whatever, or come back to the committee and do it that way, to update members on what our thinking is. But I would also say, and I mean this genuinely, I know a number of members of the committee, Stephen Kerr would be a case in point, have taken a great deal of interest in the principles of reform of the sector. My door's open to anyone who wants to come and talk to me about their thinking on this, because this is a fantastic opportunity to make much-needed change and to get it right. So I think it's important that we interrogate this, we look at whether there are any unintended consequences that would flow from anything that James has recommended, and then get on with addressing the reform agenda.
Okay, thank you. Just on that back of that then, I mean, what you're talking about is maybe just over a couple of months, really, or just over that anyway, maybe 3 months. But I think, and it's not for me to make any decisions on this for this committee, but I think it would be before you actually stood in front of Parliament to bring it back to this committee and show us what is going to be implemented so that we can interrogate it to some degree before it was actually presented in Parliament would be a good thing to do. Do you think that would be reasonable?
Well, I mean, just to give myself a little bit of wiggle room there, you mentioned 3 months. I didn't say 3 months. I said as early as it's feasible after the recess. What process ought to be followed is something for Parliament to determine. If it was felt appropriate that coming in front of the committee was the right thing, I'd be more than happy to do that. I'm happy to have an informal discussion with committee members as well, collectively or individually, about their thinking on it, or if we do a statement to Parliament. But I recognise the intense and justifiable interest in the review. There's also purpose and principles to be considered alongside that, and the two things need to be read together. So happy to do whatever Parliament feels is appropriate by way of further updating of our thinking.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Stephanie Callaghan, over to yourself. Sorry, you're okay? You're fine. Willie Rennie, please.
One of the implications of the Withers Review might be research funding for universities. Has the Minister had any thoughts, because the Withers Review obviously doesn't cover that because it's skills focused, but nevertheless it would have quite significant implications for it. Has the Minister got any thinking about that, or is it still too early?
So you're right, it really isn't picked up in the review, but we've had some conversations about with University of Scotland about that, and they're right to have raised those issues. I think that one of the concerns that's been raised is the recommendation around the funding body. Who should be a new funding body with powers taken from three different directions? And I think that's caused a degree of disquiet around research. All I can say is that we entirely recognise the importance of research funding.
Because that is my point. I've raised this before. The performance of Scottish research in terms of attracting UK Research Council funding has dipped. And we've been excellent at it. We're just not as good as we used to be. I think the universities are anxious that perhaps the government doesn't fully understand the connection between research, applied science, economic opportunity. And although the Minister has referred repeatedly to the budget challenges, this decline in performance on research predates all of that. And is relative to the UK that's faced the same financial envelope. So I just want a reassurance that the Minister does fully understand the value of research, is prepared to invest in the long run, will make sure that the new funding arrangements will take that into account, and there will be, especially as government's keen to re-engage with business and economic opportunity, that this will be at the heart of it.
I entirely recognise the role of research and universities in all of this.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Megan Gallagher, did you have a supplementary? You caught my eye, but I wasn't certain there.
No, not this time.
You're okay, that's fine. Sorry, just... Mr Rennie, over to you again, but on the... Yes.
Mental health counsellors, I was pleased to see that Think Positive had secured its funding through the National Union of Students Scotland. Have we got any news about what's happening with the mental health counsellors? We discussed it last week. I'm just keen to see if there's any progress since.
I can't sit here today and give you an answer to that. I will just offer the reassurance it is very live at the moment. We are trying, and I recognise the end of the month is a significant date in that context. It is a very challenging situation we're in over the finances, and we are trying to find a solution still.
Okay. That's fine, convener.
Okay, that's fine. Okay, I've got a question relating to the Flexible Workforce Development Fund. I was at Edinburgh College graduation the other week, and I was hearing of a number of employers that are struggling. They're desperate for their current staff to be upskilled and retrained for their organisations to grow and expand, but the college isn't able, the funding's not quite there to match the aspirations. So I was wondering if you could maybe... help discuss about how it might be further improved to really make sure that these small, medium-sized businesses and colleges can work together to really support their
growth. We're aware of the good use to which colleges have put that fund. I go back to what I said about the very significant budget challenges we are facing. We're still working through the entirety of that. I would hope that we'll be in a position to make an announcement about the SWDF very shortly.
Would that be before recess, Minister?
Now you're trying to put me on the spot.
Sorry. You know. Okay, hopefully we'll get an update on that as soon as practically possible as well. Okay, so I'm just going round the room in case there's any other questions. Willie Rennie.
International Education Strategy, when is that going to be published?
So I go back to what I said to Mr Rennie previously about how I want to approach this and the relationship with the universities in particular. We have committed, I'm meeting the universities next week on this specific issue. I want to involve them as closely as I can in finalising the strategy.
And the National Innovation Strategy, the funding for that in relation to universities, to be able to deliver their part. Has that been worked out yet? How we get?
I think that sits with another minister, Mr. Rennie.
Right.
We can't speak for colleagues.
Right. Okay. Even the university's implications for that, you can't speak to that.
I think the universities will be engaged in conversations with other ministerial colleagues on that.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, and just, I suppose, asking in the absence of Mr. Kerr, because I'm sure he would be keen to ask this question. I know, you'd be glad. So what assessment has the Scottish Government made of the SFC forecasts finding that international fee income will make up a bigger proportion of university funding than funding body income by the end of 2023-24? I suppose we have got a concern about international students, the finance that comes from them supporting our domicile students as well.
So we're asking about the assessments that's been made.
Yeah.
I suppose that's a matter really for SFC to be working closely with institutions, to be working with them on that, and really considering as part of their kind of assurance and governance process with individual institutions, just what their approaches are, what strategies they have in place and how they're going to minimise any impact.
And do you think there's the need to look again then at the number of funded places that are available for Scottish domicile students to ensure those eligible can actually get a place at a university in Edinburgh?
We're back to the conversations we've had earlier today about, you know, if we want to put more money into a particular aspect of education, it has to come from somewhere else.
Choices, Minister, isn't it? It's all about choices. So thank you very much, Minister. That is us. We're now going to... I'll let you leave. Is that right? We'll take a slight pause. We can switch off for a minute. Is that okay? Moving on to our second item on our agenda, the committee will now consider the Lewes Castle College Transfer and Closure Scotland Order 2023, which closes Lewes Castle College from the 1st of August 2023 and transfers its property, rights, liabilities and obligations to North Highland College. The instrument is being considered under the negative procedure. Do any members have any comments to make about the subordinate legislation? No. Yes, you can.
Thank you. It's just to say, obviously, it's a fairly straightforward subordinate legislation to merge the colleges. But having spoken to people who are in rural areas, and particularly members who represent rural areas, it feels like it's another kind of budgetary pushed decision as opposed to a decision that serves rural communities best. And I just think it's worth putting that on the record, because some of these communities are already struggling to get to and from colleges. And doing that, pulling it all into one place, might mean that a larger college doesn't serve diverse areas as well as it might.
We did take a significant amount of evidence on this during our college regionalisation inquiry, so we are aware of those. So is the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instrument? Yes, agreed. Thank you. The public part of our meeting has now concluded, and we will consider the final items of our agenda in private. Thank you.